Best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now, you know? I think the most important part of what we're doing is the perennial cover. That the ground needs to be covered all the time, whether it's by grass or by trees or by both. What silvopasture is a combination of both, where there's grass growing, whether it's grass and legumes or whatever the cows might eat, and there are trees, which the cows love because they like standing under trees for shade. This pasture that we bought had been a grazing field many decades ago. And over time, for various reasons, it got left alone. What happens, at least in this part of Wisconsin, is if you leave a field like this alone, you end up with a field of invasive stuff. But the question was, what were we going to do with it? We were on a vacation and came up with a book called Grass-Fed Beef, and I couldn't stop reading it. I said, this is exactly what I want to do. I mean, the benefits of managed grazing for water quality, carbon sequestration, animal health and welfare, food quality, nutrition, all these things, they all fit together just unbelievably well. And decided actually that day that I was gonna actually change careers. Over that 10 years, we transformed what was a cow-calf operation with row crops supporting it for grains for the most part and for cash crops to what we have now, which is the entire farm is now permanent pasture or permanent hay field, grassy alfalfa or a mix of legumes and grasses. And there are places where we can graze and not make hay, for example, where we are. There are places where we can do both, and there's places where we really can't graze just because of location, and we make hay only there, although we do have plans for changing that as well over time. Some of it, the first step, was goats. The goats do an unbelievable job. If they can reach it, they'll eat it. They eat stuff that you wouldn't believe. I mean, and they just cleared out, so all of a sudden, instead of not being able to see anything after the goats went through, you actually see what you're dealing with. So once the goats came through, we then came through with the skid steer, which made it a lot easier, and pulled out trees and brush and all the rest and piled it up and get them out of the way. And then we were left with an area that was just filled with mostly dirt and weeds, and disked up the fields and seeded the fields that's late summer with oats, which then winter kills. And in February, March, I came through here and did frost seeding with one of those hand seeders, and just walked through this, took forever, but walked through this with a hand seeder into the oats, which were just laying on the ground, protecting the ground. And over a period of years, gradually that took hold, and that's why mostly what we had. Problem number one is water. I mean, you can't have cattle without water. We are lucky, and part of the reason we did this in this location is we have a stream that runs through here. We were able to access NRCS engineers to say, well, what should we do? I mean, what should we be thinking about, and how can we get this done? And they'd come out and help us. What happens by the stream is those trees grow along the stream, and then sooner or later they fall down. That's just the nature of that sort of tree. And when they fall down, they take the bank with it. And what happens, though, is that the invasive shrubs shade the ground so efficiently that underneath them is just dirt and mud. So by changing it to a grassy slope on the edge of a stream, you can stabilize the banks naturally. And you can't do that with cattle because they ruin banks. Except if you do managed grazing, where the cows only get access to that stream maybe for a few hours or a day, and then get access to something else. And if you have hardened crossings, the cows would much rather be on a shallow bank with a firm base rather than on a steep bank with a muddy base. That is the concept of silvopasture married to managed grazing, intensive managed grazing, and you end up with I think the best of all worlds. Cows get their shade, the grass gets to grow, and we do all the good things we talked about for air quality and water quality and the rest. Our cattle are what would be polluting these streams. So we sample water that basically is water that we're responsible for. This unnamed stream ends up in Mill Creek, which ends up in the Wisconsin River, which ends up in the Mississippi, which ends up in the Gulf of Mexico. And so we are, in a very tiny way, you know, responsible for trying to, you know, help with the problems in the Gulf and all on the way to the Gulf. The interest, I think, has to go beyond silvopasture. I think the interest has to be managed grazing. I think the interest has to be grass-fed something, whether it's sheep or dairy cows or beef cattle like we're doing, or goats, or even horses. We have friends that are raising horses on pasture. So there's lots of ways that you can enter this, but I think that the concept of the silvopasture just sort of folds right into the managed grazing system. You're not going to have a good silvopasture unless you manage graze it. It's the way it works. I mean, you could try. If I put the cows in here for a month, this place would just be a mess. It'd just be overgrazed. We'd end up with useless grasses and all that stuff would grow back. You know, or nothing would grow back. You'd end up with just mud that would end up in the stream. So, you know, I think the key to a good silvopasture is a good managed grazing plan.